Hello, Singhi. So today in this session, we will practice a basic Gynae examination on this pelvic model. Okay. So let's begin by talking about our instruments first. Okay.
All right.
So we do not need much for a Gynae examination. Mm-hmm. Okay. We have here a pelvic model, which we will describe later. All we need is a basic speculum. Okay. Do you know the name of this instrument?
This is a Cascow speculum.
Okay.
It is actually a bivalve speculum.
Uh-huh.
And in this case, it's clearly it's a disposable speculum.
Yes. So that means it's once use only.
Exactly.
Okay. Do you know that there is a steel version of it? That's the old fashioned. Mm-hmm. And the kind of one you may be familiar with using in colposcopy.
That's right.
Okay. So that obviously has to be sterilized. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you know of any other speculum that we can use for the Gynae examination or we use? Mm.
There's also the SIMS speculum.
Okay.
SIMS speculum is a single valve speculum. It's often used in the operating theatres.
Correct.
When the patient is under.
And when we have help,
extra
so somebody needs to retract, right?
That's right.
Okay. Mm. All right. Good. So is this the only speculum available? Or there are other sizes?
There are usually three sizes available.
Mm-hmm.
And they are actually color coded so that it's easier for us to understand.
Okay.
All right. So in this case, this is the yellow, so-called yellow speculum. It also comes in a yellow plastic bag,
uh-huh.
and is considered the medium-sized speculum.
Okay.
There is a smaller size one, which is a pink, and
mm-hmm.
there is a larger size one, which is green.
So when do we use the pink, when do we use the yellow, and when do we use the green?
So for most women, we can usually use the yellow medium-sized speculum.
Mm-hmm.
However, for certain ladies, for example, the postmenopausal ladies
mm-hmm.
or the nulliparous, mm-hmm. they might be more comfortable if we use the pink speculum.
You mean the smaller?
The smaller
oh,
one.
I see.
Yes, and for people who have had multiple vaginal deliveries before where the vaginal walls may be a bit lax
mm-hmm.
or some ladies who are larger size,
mm-hmm.
then the green speculum may help us more.
You mean the larger one? Oh, I see.
That's
okay,
right.
Makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, shall we demonstrate the examination there?
Sure.
Here is Mrs. Smith. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I will take the role of questioning you as well as the patient. Okay.
Okay.
So take us through an examination then. Mm-hmm.
Sure. So in the gynecological examination, of course, I'll first introduce myself.
Okay.
So, good morning, Mrs. Smith. I'm Dr. Lee here.
Mm-hmm.
Today, I'll need to perform a gynecological examination for you. All right. This will consist of two parts mainly.
Okay.
One is an examination of your tummy,
okay.
and then we will need to move on to do a vagina as well as an speculum examination for you.
Doctor, I'm very scared. Is it painful?
I understand you.
I haven't had pap smear because I'm so scared. You know.
I understand you might be quite anxious about having a vagina examination done,
mm-hmm.
alright? But please be rest assured that I'll keep you notified exactly what we are doing at each point of time,
okay?
The whole process should not cause you any pain. There might be some slight discomfort, and I'll inform you before there's any actions that we are taking which might cause you discomfort so that you can have some mental preparation.
Okay. Thank you, Doctor. I feel much better.
No worries. Alright, so we shall begin now. I need you to just go behind the curtain.
Okay.
I need you to remove your bottom halves and get onto the examination table and just lie flat for me.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Doctor.
So once the patient has actually prepared on the examination table, we will actually first begin with the abdominal examination.
Okay.
Therefore, for patient's privacy, we will usually cover up to the suprapubic region for the tummy examination,
mm-hmm.
and usually an exposure just below the ziphy sternum to the suprapubic region will be sufficient.
And what is the purpose of abdominal examination when the actually gynae structures are much lower?
Because we do realize that mm-hmm. in certain gynecological pathologies,
mm-hmm.
for example, large ovarian cysts or masses,
mm-hmm.
they may actually be palpable in the abdominal examination.
Oh, I see. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So first, we will do obtain a sufficient exposure, and then of course we will perform hand hygiene before we do any examination. Alright, so Mrs. Smith, I will start checking your tummy now.
Okay.
Alright, so first I'll do an inspection to check for any obvious masses or distension of the tummy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then I will also look for any presence of previous scars. So in this case, there's no obvious masses and there's also no scars. Then I will next move on to palpation. Before I begin, I will ask Mrs. Smith, do you have any pain in the tummy right now?
I have a little bit of discomfort on my lower right side, Doctor.
I see. So in that case, we will begin the palpation away from the area where Mrs. Smith is feeling the pain.
Okay.
Okay. So when I'm doing the palpation, I will also look at Mrs. Smith to see whether she has any expressions of pain or discomfort.
Good.
Okay. So do let me know if you feel any pain, Mrs. Smith, otherwise I'll start feeling your tummy now. Okay. So I'll palpate the tummy to feel for any tenderness or any masses, starting away from the region of pain that the patient might be experiencing. So as I'm nearing the region, I will also let her know that I'm actually coming near the area of pain. Is there any pain that you are feeling when I'm
just
pressing?
Just very
right
slight
now?
Discomfort.
I see. If I'm pressing and there's some tenderness, I will also move on to elicit whether there's any evidence of rebound or guarding.
Okay, good.
Okay. So when the tummy examination is done, I will actually move on to do the speculum examination.
Let's do a speculum examination.
Sure. Okay, so I will actually cover back for the patient. And then in this case, Mrs. Smith, I will actually need you to help me bend your knees up and open your legs to the side and relax them. Okay, so the examination might be slightly uncomfortable, all right, but if you actually relax yourselves and try to relax your buttocks down, it'll be done in the jiffy.
Okay.
So first we will do the speculum examination before doing the bimanual examination. So for the speculum, before beginning the speculum examination, yes, I will definitely need some lubrication. Thank you. Very good. Okay, and then we'll do a quick inspection of the vulvar area to look for any obvious vulvar lesions. After which, I'll ensure that I have a light source so that I can perform the speculum examination.
Sure.
Have the lubrication, well lubricate both sides of the speculum.
Sure.
Yeah. So we can either hold the speculum in this fashion or some might hold it in this fashion. This is really personal preference.
That's correct.
Okay. So I will gently part the labial folds just very slightly, and then I will ease the speculum in. Mrs. Smith, you might be feeling a little bit of discomfort now, alright?
I'm okay, doctor.
Very good. Alright, so just relax yourself, okay? And then once I'm in, I will actually open to see whether I can locate the cervix. So if I'm, sometimes I may not be able to locate the cervix, in which case I might need to retract the speculum a little bit, readjust, and then open it again to look for the cervix. So now I'm able to see the cervix in whole as well as the visualized cervical.
Yes. And does it look normal?
And it looks normal. There are no obvious cervical lesions or masses. Mm-hmm. There's also no bleeding.
Any other significant finding?
Mm. I will also at the same time look at the vaginal vault, see whether there are any vaginal lesions, whether there's any bleeding, whether there's any discharge or prolapse.
That's
right. Okay. So next, I'm actually moving on to do a pap smear. Okay, so for that, I can actually turn the knob here to make the speculum self-retaining.
Okay.
So that I can free up one hand to actually do the pap smear. Okay. So again, I visualize the cervical os and I perform the pap smear. Okay, and then I can remove my instrument.
Is there any other procedures you can do at this?
Yes,
stage.
At this point of time, we can actually also to perform vaginal swabs if there's evidence of discharge or if we are suspicious of any vaginal infection. If there's a need or indication for endometrial sampling, this is also the time to perform
it. I see. Okay.
So when we are done with the pap smear in this case and we are done with the speculum examination, I will release the self-retaining knob, let the speculum close and ease it up gently so as to not cause discomfort.
That was not bad at all, doctor.
That's good. So now we will actually move on to the bimanual examination.
Okay.
So again, I will need to have lubrication. Okay. And Mrs. Smith, I will now perform the bimanual examination for you. Okay. It's an internal check. Might cause you a little bit of discomfort. But again, if you relax yourself, it will be done just in a moment.
Okay.
So first, I will insert my index as well as my middle finger into the vagina and following the axis of the vagina, so it's usually slightly posterior.
Mm-hmm.
Then I will actually try to feel for the cervix, and in this case I can feel for the cervix, and then I will move to feel the region of the posterior fornix as well. After that, I will actually perform a bimanual examination to look for the signs of the uterus, the virgin of the uterus, whether there is any abnormal contour or abnormal masses, and whether there is any tenderness.
Okay.
So in this case, the uterus feels normal sized and antiverted. And is there any pain when I'm feeling?
No, doctor.
Okay, that's good. So there's no tenderness and there's no abnormal masses.
Okay, what happens next?
So after this, I will actually need to move on to do an annexer check.
Okay.
So again, it's a bimanual palpation of the annexer region. Okay. First the right and then the left.
Okay.
Again, to feel for any annexer masses or any tenderness.
All right.
Okay. Then that concludes my vagina examination.
Thank you, doctor. That wasn't bad at all.
No worries. Okay. So,
you can get dressed now.
Yes.
All right. So Cindy, what do we have here? What are all these models?
All right. So as you can see here, there are various models showing both the normal uterus as well as a uteruses with pathology and an XL with pathology.
Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. So shall we look, have a closer look at them?
Sure. So in this case, right here in the center, we can see the normal uterus as well as the normal tubes and the ovaries.
I see.
Okay. So this is for, can be inserted into the pelvic trainer. So
that, that we just practiced on.
Exactly. Oh, so that we can actually feel it and practice before we even touch an actual patient.
Oh, I think that's great for confidence, you know.
I believe so. So besides the normal uterus, we also need to familiarize ourselves with when they are abnormal or they are pathological problems.
Okay. All right. What pathology are the, what are the common pathologies in them?
So some of the models here actually show it very easily. So like in this case, we have uteruses with some pathology. So in, for example, in this model, right, there is a large mass growing out of the uterus. So most commonly, it's probably a fibroid.
Okay. And this is the subserous one, right?
Looks like it.
Seeing
the position.
Going towards the outside, right?
That's right.
Okay. And what is this then?
Exactly. And in this case, you can see that this is looks like a globally enlarged kind of a uterus. So this is very likely to be an adenomyotic uterus.
Oh, I see.
And,
and what do we have here?
That's right. Besides the uterine pathologies, we also need to practice and be familiar with annexal problems as well as ovarian problems.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So for example, in this case, we can immediately tell just by looking at this and comparing to the normal one that the tube here is enlarged as compared to the normal one.
So this is a hydrosalpinx, right?
Very commonly so.
Oh, I see.
So when we fit this into the trainer, we can actually palpate the annexal structures and feel for the presence of hydrosalpinx.
Oh, I see. This is what it feels like.
That's right.
Okay.
And in this case, we can see clearly that there are two varying sizes of ovarian cysts or ovarian masses. So again, this they is also inflatable, and so we can actually alter the size of the cyst.
So we can blow it up with this, is it?
That's right.
Okay.
So obviously, the larger the cyst or mass is, the easier for us to feel on the pelvic trainer.
Oh, I see. I think this is brilliant.
I think it's quite good for us to practice. Huh?
Yeah, and to learn about things before we actually see a patient.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.